dan juga kita ada WAP TV, ya. Jadi saya kira ramai yang melihat dalam Facebook WAP TV ataupun di YouTube, dan di konti Zoom kita ini sekarang ini ada 19 orang peserta, insyaAllah. Okay. Jadi tajuk kita pada petang ini adalah satu tajuk yang sangat saya kira penting dan tak boleh dilupakan, kerana ia berkaitan dengan falsafah pendidikan. Dan falsafah pendidikan kita tahu dia adalah merupakan penentu hala tuju kemana arah kita nak bawa pendidikan kita, dan dia juga membicarakan tentang wahana atau mekanisme untuk mencapai matlamat tersebut. Walaupun FPK telah dirumus begitu lama pada tahun 88, jadi maknanya sudah hampir 32 tahun ya FPK ini wujud. Dan kalau kita lihatkan generasi pertama yang sudah graduate daripada FPK ini sekarang berusia hampir 45 tahun. Jadi kalau kita dah lihat macam peringkat umur 45 tahun tu adalah garis batasannya antara mereka yang bersekolah mengikuti FPK dan mereka yang tidak mengikuti FPK. Ya. Jadi oleh kerana itu satu masa yang sudah lama, sudah tentu banyak peristiwa yang berlaku dalam sama dalam negara maupun di peringkat global, dan sudah ada tentu kita kena lihat FPK ini macam mana relevannya dan juga perlu diterjemah dan ditafsir untuk era pendidikan abad ke-21. Jadi dalam program ini insyaAllah kita akan mulakan dengan ucapan aluan daripada Dekan Kuliah Pendidikan UIA iaitu Prof. Ainul, ya. Kemudian kita diikuti dengan ucapan atau bicara pertama oleh yang terkemuka Tan Sri Wan Zahid Nordin, ya. Dan juga diikuti selepas itu dengan sesi soal jawab. Jadi saya minta para peserta sediakan soalan-soalan yang ingin dikemukakan. Selepas itu barulah kita akan disusulkan dengan Profesor Tan Sri Zul sebagai pembicara kedua. Jadi tanpa melengahkan masa lagi, saya ingin menjemput sekarang ini Profesor Ainul Zubairi Ainul Maziah, ya, Zubairi untuk memberi kata-kata aluannya. Silakan.
Terima kasih Prof. Nani. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alamin. Wassalatu wassalamu ala ashrafil anbiya wal mursalin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajmain. Yang berbahagia Tan Sri Wan Zahid Nordin, mantan KPPM dan juga Pro-Chancellor USAS. Yang berbahagia Profesor Emeritus Tan Sri Zulkifli Abdul Razak, Rector of IIUM. Profesor Rosnani dan juga Profesor Ajang di Kuliah of Education IIUM dan juga moderator kita hari ini. Tetamu-tetamu khas, kami ada tetamu khas daripada JPN, juga tetamu khas daripada KPM, daripada EPRD, para-para pendidik, para pensyarah dari Kuliah of Education, para pendidik, semua yang menghadiri webinar ini. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Assalamualaikum.
Pertama sekali saya ingin mengucapkan ribuan terima kasih kepada yang telah bekerjasama dengan penganjur Kuliah of Education, terutamanya Prof. Rosnani lah di bawah Center of Teaching Thinking CTT Kuliah of Education, kerana telah berjaya setelah beberapa cabaran. Kami ingin menjayakan ini daripada awal tahun, so ini dah akhir bulan Mac. Alhamdulillah kita dah berjaya menganjur siri pertama daripada beberapa siri yang akan datang tentang FPK. Untuk maklumat semua, so webinar hari ini yang bertajuk yang kita nampak FPK pasal 21 dan cabarannya, kenapa perlu pentaksiran semula, ini adalah salah satu yang pertama daripada siri. Kita akan ada 6 atau 7 topik-topik sehingga bulan Ogos. So saya berharap yang menghadiri hari ini akan terus tidak sahaja menjayakan tetapi akan terus menghadiri webinar yang seterusnya, di mana kami harap memberi peluang untuk kita bukan saja mendengar ya webinar pembentangan, tapi juga untuk kita bersama-sama to share our spirit ya, untuk menambahbaikan dan inspirasi baru di dalam era baru ini untuk menambahbaikan pendidikan di negara kita. Saya juga mengambil peluang ini ya untuk berkongsi ya salah satu impetus ataupun kenapa kami ingin juga ya try our best untuk mengadakan webinar series ini. Ini adalah kerana sambutan yang sangat meriah yang kami terima daripada penerbitan buku ini. So I must share the good news ya, yang buku ni falsafah pendaftaran baru falsafah pendidikan kebangsaan dan pelaksanaan pasca 2020 bukan saja telah menerima anugerah buku perdana 2019 oleh MAPIN, tetapi juga anugerah karya suntikan terbaik sains sosial dan kemanusiaan MAPIN KPT 2019. Ini tidak terbatas kepada anugerah, tetapi this book ya telah menjadi kitab kepada ramai yang berminat dan juga ingin berkongsi ya pengalaman dan inspirasi untuk penambahbaikan pendidikan di negara kita. So this is out of order, kita kena order lagi dan ramai lagi yang berminat ya. Tapi untuk of this book, di sinilah saya ingin mengambil peluang untuk persuade ya, dan juga mengalu-alukan kehadiran all of you untuk menghadiri webinar-webinar series yang seterusnya. So akhir sekali, saya bagi pihak Kuliah Higher Education, IIUM, ingin mengucapkan ribuan terima kasih kepada para-para pembentang hari ini, khususnya Tan Sri Zul dan juga Tan Sri Wan Zahid, kerana telah meluangkan masa untuk hari ini. Okay. Dan kepada yang lain, kami juga berharap akan terus bersama kami dalam siri-siri yang akan datang, dan kami akan gunakan apa ni peluang ini untuk juga mendengar inspirasi yang lain-lain ya, dalam misi yang sama. So dengan itu, saya again mengucapkan terima kasih kepada Profesor Rosnani agree untuk menjadi moderator untuk hari ini. Okay, sekian. Terima kasih. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Terima kasih saya ucapkan kepada Prof. Ainul. Jadi kita ada sebagai pembicara pertama, pensyarah pertama, seorang ahli pendidik, tokoh pendidikan yang tidak asing lagi, yang sebenarnya tidak memerlukan diperkenalkan lagi, ya, iaitu Tan Sri Datuk Sri Wan Zahid. Yang telah berkecimpung dalam bidang pendidikan begitu lama di Malaysia, mula dengan peringkat guru dan akhirnya menjadi ketua pengarah pendidikan pada tahun 1993. Kemudian yang terakhir beliau menjadi pengerusi Majlis Pendidikan Penasihat Pendidikan Kebangsaan pada tahun 2018-2019. Saya kira banyak di Tan Sri juga banyak berkecimpung dalam bidang pendidikan tinggi dalam konteks beliau merupakan pengerusi lembaga pengarah UPSI dan mantan Pro Chancellor Universiti Sultan Azlan Shah Perak, dan juga pernah menjadi penasihat pengerusi lembaga pengarah ya, untuk Institute of Science and Technology saya ingat ya, dan juga pengerusi badan penasihat AKEP untuk pengajian tinggi. Selain itu beliau juga berkecimpung dalam bidang korporat, iaitu sebagai pengarah lembaga pengarah, ahli lembaga pengarah pada beberapa syarikat seperti SP Setia, Sime Darby, PNB, Amanah Saham, Yayasan Pekra dan sebagainya. Jadi daripada ini kita dapat semasa FPK digubal dan semasa, terutama semasa ia dilaksanakan di bawah KBSM, iaitu kita panggil satu reformasi pendidikan, Tan Sri adalah orang yang memikul tanggungjawab tersebut. Jadi saya kira amatlah layak sekiranya beliau boleh memberi komentar sepanjang 32 tahun ni perkembangan dan juga penilaian dan juga bagaimana hala tujunya ya. Adakah beliau sendiri berpuas hati sebagai seorang pengasasnya ataupun melihat banyak kelopongan lagi. Jadi tanpa kita melengahkan masa, saya menjemput Tan Sri Wan Zahid untuk membicarakan tajuknya. Silakan.
Terima kasih. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Saya akan mengucapkan saudara-saudari sekalian, I am getting very, very old. So, go on, you're not able to be happy. But there are certain things that I want to mention here and take advantage. Sebab ramai yang orang muda di sini. Supaya dia orang berfikir. Kalau kita tengok bagaimana kita mendekati kita punya, let me begin with stating that. Sebab after that, you're going to get full of your chat. Kita selalunya cakap tentang dua aspek. Satunya, the philosophy. Number two, the man. We always talk about the philosophy only. What it should be, kita nak change ini, kita nak buat ini and all that. What about the man? Dia nak carry. Mampukah dia carry? Bukan mana. This to me is very important because I want to share my experience. Because you must have that guts, that audacity to do the unlikely. People don't expect you to do. Okay? You must be able to do that. Bukan buat itu. And I would like to relate my experience. Because somebody, nobody wants to listen to me, but I want to relate my personal experience. Okay, bila I, this is where I talk about the man who is going to carry the burden of responsibility so that people can benefit from it. Not he benefits from that position that he seeks. So, I would like to get this experience. Bila saya balik daripada Berkeley, I sat down. Sorry lah, I just a bit of digression and then you all take a lot of time, but this is for you to think. Balik itu, jadi saya attended one lecture given by the Honorable Minister of Education, no less than the Honorable Tun Musuh Hitam at that time, Datuk Hitam, he was the Minister of Education. He said, all these people, you all go and all that, and that. What have you done? You all have done nothing. So he was challenging us. And so a few friends of mine said, hey, you nak terus tak pula, I nak jaga, I punya periuk nasi ni. Have you been talking about periuk nasi ni? So I say, okay, kita tengok itu, I stood up. I said, Datuk, are you very serious that you will give us the latitude, the space to carry out what we want, what we think should be done, without fear or favor? You say, why not? So, okay. After that, we left, and then I put in my papers, and we were supposed also to apply and put in papers, become pengarah pelajaran. I said, if I want to do something, I expect to become pengarah pelajaran, be at the helm of it and do it. Come with me. They don't like it, they can sack me. I thought, I never knew I had that courage. But anyway, we went and then I got a job. I became the first pengarah of Negeri Sembilan. And that was the time I introduced the blueprint. And the blueprint was a headache a lot of people because it was a headache to Datuk Musa Hitam because they don't like that kind of thing. And they said that this one is going to affect their influence and all that. And they are not going to vote him because that, that time he was fighting with Tengku Razali for the post of deputy president. So I put in my this one, and of course there was a lot of controversy, a lot of fireworks and all that, and they didn't like it. So they sent a telegram to Mr. Hidam. Take this man out, he's crazy. they think that the blueprint is crazy. They was trying to do something different. To try to build people so that they can, you know, contribute something. They don't like it. So they ask him to get me out. And then 1 week later, I was called by the Menteri Besar. I think you changed. Tak apalah, tak salah banyak-banyak. Bukan ni, atau lah, you baru balik daripada universiti and all that. Cukuplah buat sikit. I say, no, that will be against my principle. Hey, you have a future, you know, want to be Director General of Education, so be it. There's no point becoming Director General of Education, I can contribute anything. I hope people recall that. And then, we went on. So the next day, I was called again by the Director General of Education, who then was Tan Sri Musa Jawaharlal. He said, you have to take it out, or I have to take you out. So I said to him, all right, so this is going to be my future. I'm going to stand here. Let me see the Minister of Education. So when I saw the Minister of Education, I said, sir, I asked for this job. I am prepared to stand by it. Come with me. I feel that I can do it. I will do it. Then I have a lot of cowards in the Ministry of Education. I will do it. I will do all these kind of things. But last time, you said that you must stand by what you feel, what you believe, and all that kind of thing. You need much of anything and all that. But anyway, he tried to tone me down. I said, all right, so be it. So you have signed your death warrant. By today, you're going to be removed. So I accept the body. He said, never mind. And after that, when I went back, I told my wife, well, it's going to be a very short stay in Negeri Sembilan. For me, as far as I'm concerned. But after that, you know, 2 weeks later, I thought, Musa Hitam is a great man. He sent a telegram. I stand by my men. Wow. What an endorsement that I got. So I went to see him. I said, this is what I'm going to do. You know that. And yes, you go ahead and do it and deliver it. You don't deliver it, I'm going to kick your pants. So, you know, I mean, this is the kind of what I'm saying. It's not a long story short. Sit there just talking about philosophy. You should talk about the men. He's going to deliver on. Although you keep on. We keep on revising for that. He never does anything. We must have people who are brave enough to make that decision. Let him be brave enough, let him stand up and say that. And I did. Not bukan, no. I've been blowing a trumpet, but I think this is very important because we have very important high stakes in education. And if we have people who are very tentative, there's no point. You just enrich the man by whatever position that he has. Until now, let me tell you, people are afraid to even implement autonomy. Autonomy is not implemented. What is this? You spend millions. You came up with all the fantastic words and all that. Nothing happened. People do not cannot even, you know, do it. Why can't, you know? And I thought that I did the thing unthinkable. I changed everything. Medication. I said that no timetable. What should we have done to do? We let's do it something different. We all did everything different with the people. We got together with people. People who are brave enough. I think we have this. Then we don't have to meet next year trying to think about how to change we can do something, achieve something. Let us achieve something and be brave enough, have the guts to do it, I dare even say. I know that these people are not going to be very nice to me, but never mind. Because I'm old already. So if I go to 6 feet underground, you can't dig me. So, but I think this is a very important thing that we should think about. Just instead of coming here for the philosophy, but about getting the man to really do it, to really push it. Let us identify the man. What kind of man? How do we want it? How are we going to build it? All those kind of things. That those who do not have the guts, stay away. Minta maaf lah kalau saya dah terlajak. Ini apa benar orang tua terlajak. So, for what it is worth, I shared this because this to me is very important because these are empirical evidence that we have people who not collected. That we have done certain things, that changed things and all that. And inshallah, if we were to do it, we get it, we'll get it right, inshallah. Then we get out. Thank you. Thank you for listening to me. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Itu ucapan Tan Sri yang ringkas tapi padat ya, dan bersesuaian dengan menceritakan pengalamannya. Dan pengalaman ini sangat sangat penting, dan apa yang beliau menyatakan tentang keperluan wujudnya insan yang berani pada kebenaran, ya. Berani berusaha menentang arus, ya. Sangat penting walaupun kita mempunyai FPK yang baik, yang indah, tapi tiada insan-insan sama ada dari segi pegawai yang tinggi kepada guru bilik darjah yang berani memperjuangkan yang benar, kita tak, mungkin kita tak mengalami apa yang berlaku dengan FPK dan KBSM. Apabila beliau menceritakan tentang pengalamannya di Negeri Sembilan, saya teringat ketika itu saya mengajar di Mata Rendah Sains Semara. Dan memang Tan Sri Wan Zahid terkenal ketika itu kerana beliau memperkenalkan method projection, exam score punya projection. Dan semua guru kena project dengan student's potential achievement and the reach of the target. Betul kata Tan Sri? Saya ingat itu yang guru tak mahu buat projection tu. Dan work hard to achieve the projected figures. Nah, itu saya ingat sebab walaupun MRSM bukan dalam sistem pendidikan kebangsaan, tapi dia mengikuti kurikulum dan semuanya. Jadi kami juga terpaksa melaksanakan demikian. Tapi memang betul ada banyak rungutan. Dan saya ingat lepas tu Tan Sri ke Kelantan, tak silap saya. anyway, saya rasa sangat bertuah sebab dia menceritakan tentang keperluan courage, keberanian. Dan kita sangat memerlukan sifat tersebut pada masa sekarang, khususnya di negara kita ini dalam keadaan situasi yang kita alami sekarang. Jadi kalau saya buka sekarang kepada pertanyaan, saya ingat dalam chat sini masih belum ada lagi Tan Sri sebab terlalu pendek mungkin, dia pun tak sempat. Tapi boleh bertanya secara lisan ya. Kalau ada siapa nak bertanya secara lisan, saya tak tahu sama ada di YouTube dan di Web TV ada sekarang komen Brother Izzuddin ya, itu punya anggota yang memerhati di sana, ada komen atau soalan. Okay, kita buka kepada pertanyaan daripada semua yang hadir di Zoom ini. Seramai sekarang kita ada 35 orang di Zoom ya. Sebarang pertanyaan jangan lepaskan peluang ini ya, sebab gergasi ada di sini. Okey, ada soalan daripada Prof Zul sendiri. Prof nak cakap ke saya nak tanyakan? Okey, pertanyaan Prof Zul pada Tan Sri, apakah prognosis Tan Sri tentang FPK untuk masa hadapan? Tan Sri.
Apa tu?
Apakah prognosis, ni diagnosis, prognosis ya, Tan Sri tentang FPK untuk masa hadapan?
I think if you all get together, you all are very clever people here. Get together, discuss things and all that, you will come up with something that you really be surprised. And I will be very happy and honored to just join in. Pasal apa, we owe it to our people. Our people have been denied. It's a terrible denial if you look at it. study of denial, initial denial. And we have not got what we want. It is not we don't have the people. We have the people. You know, if I could do it at that time, and you know, if I just a bit of any aggression, when I was kicked to from Rengsimilan, as you mentioned, to Kelantan. And Kelantan wanted to have what I had too. And I said, all right, if you want, you'll be on my terms again. But I want to see all your escorts. See your escorts, I want to tell them what they have to do. And you have to be prepared to what I'm going to say. And then time, I find more people say, all right, I'm going to have it. I'm going to let you have this one. And then I told them, this is what we have to do. And you have to accept it. And then we can achieve what we have never achieved before. This is the thing that we do. This is the time to do it. And I can do that. Sometimes Kelantan sometimes can go a bit of the way, you know. But they did it. They did it. And we became the best. And we were able to beat the best. And so I thought that we can do that. But this thing doesn't last. They said, you know, after I left, they decided to change them. Pogara. This is crazy, man. You don't want it to be there forever for you. So it was a short spell. But it was a nice experience because at least I had the empirical evidence, which I can share with all the honored people here today. Thank you.
Baik, ada lagi pertanyaan, Tan Sri. Tapi sama ada Tan Sri tak cerita tentang pentafsiran baru ni. Soalannya daripada Rushdan tanya, apakah kesan kepada pentafsiran baru ini kepada dunia pendidikan? Jadi kita belum bicara, jadi kita tak tahu apa yang dia maksudkan sebab kita tak bicara lagi kesan pentafsiran baru. Mungkin Tan Sri ada nak bicara tentang apa agaknya kalau kita nak tafsirkan yang baru untuk MK kita.
You have the capacity to do it. Believe in us. Believe. You have to believe. And you get it done. Wow, it's a beautiful thing when it happens. I'm telling you. Take it from me.
Okay, mungkin Tan Sri saya nak tambah kat situ mungkin. Adakah benar pada pandangan Tan Sri bahawa kualiti pendidikan kita sekarang ini makin lama makin merosot, iaitu sehinggakan banyak ibu bapa yang merungut atau komplain? Dan kalau ia merosot, apa pandangan Tan Sri puncanya? Adakah puncanya daripada ketidakberanian guru-guru menyatakan pendapat mereka secara bebas, ataupun ada terlampau ketat kekangan daripada atas? Sila Tan Sri, sambung dengan persoalan tersebut.
I probably answered it earlier. This one, you see, the people are looking towards us. Help them, release them, and then deliver it for them. And memang boleh, I tell you, memang boleh. Kan apa ni ya? Saya banyak cerita. Okay, I tell you, macam mana beraninya guru? I give them, if you allow me a little bit.
Sure. Alright. Silakan.
Apa ni? Ketika saya buat blueprint itu, I say all schools must achieve the best. And ada sekolah yang tak bagus. And ada sekolah yang teruk. Di Kelantan. Ada kalau orang Kelantan ada sini, ada kemarin sekolah 0%. Tak pernah budak-budak lulus. Masuk dari sekolah itu, habis je. So, apa ni? People have accepted this. I say, no, we must change. Kita perlu ubah ni. Kita mesti carikan. Sama-sama guru, I say, I want you all to achieve. I am going to give you freedom. I give you freedom. But you should say freedom apa yang wisely. And then dia boleh buat. Jadi, apa yang berlaku ialah, dia orang balik ke sekolah. Dia kata, guru besar, apa ni, pengarah kepelajaran kita ni, gila. Kita memang tak boleh. Dia punya buat macam mana. Semua orang tak bagus. Dan baca pun tak boleh, apa tak boleh. Macam mana nak buat? So dia kata, mari, apa dia boleh beri pada kita? Dia kata, fikir. So he started thinking. And dia orang sama-sama sendiri fikir, okay, macam mana kita buat? sama-sama bincang. And then dia orang kata, budak berjah. Lima mungkin tak boleh baca. Tapi kita tu ajar dia lagi, macam mana kita nak buat? Nama sama-sama sendiri dia orang kata, okay. Dia kata, kita boleh buat apa-apa? Ya, boleh buat apa-apa. Alright. Sekarang ni, kita turunkan budak. Jadi berjah lima, turun berjah satu. Supaya tak guna ajar dia berjah lima yang dia tak tahu. So, dia started thinking. Dia fikir sama sendiri. And sebenarnya lepas dia orang fikir, you know, that, alright, this is what we will do. So dia orang kata, eh, kita ni berani ni, tak ni. Pengarah kata apa? Oh, pengarah kata apa? Sama-sama dia orang kata, dia dah kata kita boleh buat. Tak usah kita royak kat dia, dia kata. Gunta lima ni tu. Ya, gunta duit. Tapi boleh deliver you. Sebenarnya itu berlaku. Asas kemahuan atas apa ni, ya. Inovasi dia orang ni semua tu. Dia berjaya memecahkan telur sekolah itu dan mencapai kejayaan yang cepat. Itu saya dah tulis satu paper. Saya presented tu. To my people. America, because you see, wow, we never thought that people are capable of higher thinking, higher order thinking. Yes, because kalau kita bagi dia mereka peluang, opportunity, keberanian, dan we stand by them. Kalau apa-apa berlaku, we must stand by them. Itu dia. Jadi itu yang saya nak share. Tidak yang tanya tadi, itu sesama sendiri boleh cari. Sebenarnya penyelesaian adalah using kita sebenarnya mempunyai kebolehan. Jadi kalau ada orang yang stand in the way, kata ini tak dibuat, ini tak ikut peraturan semua, tak ikut peraturan semua tu, habislah. Give up.
Ya, betul Tan Sri. Itu satu daripada masalah. Saya ingat guru-guru dan pegawai pendidikan yang menonton pada petang ni boleh fahami ya pandangan Tan Sri ini, dan dia mengatakan kita kena berani. Sebab saya pun lihat begitulah keadaannya, dan itulah yang menyebabkan saya ingat satu punca ya, kenapa kita tak boleh maju ke depan. Ada lagi satu soalan Tan Sri di sini daripada Dr. Zainurin daripada Kuwait. Beliau bertanya, kenapa susah sangat kita nak bersama-sama menjiwai FPK? Ada yang kata ini adalah seperti pendidikan tidak berjiwa. Adakah unsur ekonomi menjadi lebih penting? Dan
kalau kita nak cari apa yang tak boleh buat tu, kacau kita. Kita cari yang kita boleh buat. Nah, saya dulu cari apa yang saya boleh buat. This is what we are going to do. This is how we are going to achieve it. Okay, macam mana? Dan kita telah berjaya. Dan memang masa dulu, Kelantan amat berjaya sampai negeri lain datang melawatkan untuk belajar macam mana Kelantan buat ini. Nah, itu dia. Jadi saya ingat, janganlah kita fikir yang kita tidak ada kemampuan. Kita ada kemampuan, and tak ada siapa yang ada hak untuk menahan kita daripada mencapai kemampuan kita itu. Itu adalah amat penting bagi kita untuk capai hanya. Kalau sekolah, saya nak bagi sekejap. Sekolah Jalan Bayan, the worst school in Malaysia. School for lost souls. Tak ada apa. Saya berikan dia orang ini, alright. Aman you. Tengok macam mana. Beat Tengku Syah dengan Malikot. And did it. Mengapa ni ya, dalam satu tahun dia orang buat itu. Jadi memang dia orang boleh buat, semua orang boleh buat, tapi dengan syarat mesti ada facilitator. Jangan ada yang orang yang apa ni, tahankan, tak mau bagi kita buat kerja, tak mau denial. Ini yang denial ni dia takut lose dia punya prestige. Kali orang tak jumpa dia semua, all this apa ni, bangkum punya idea. Dia mesti bukakan dirinya untuk semua. I tell you, hari ini boleh banyak berubah sebenarnya. InsyaAllah.
Tan Sri, satu soalan lagi. Ini berkaitan dengan KBSM. Ya, ini soalannya saya gabungkan lah ya. Pertama, antara komen yang sering disebut adalah curriculum standard yang kita gunakan dalam KSSR atau KSSM ini sudah hilang semangat, ikut pendidikan bersepadu seperti mana ketika KBSR dan KBSM. Sedangkan semangat pendidikan bersepadu adalah semangat penting dalam SPK. Macam mana komen Tan Sri?
Mudah saja, sorry, I tend to oversimplify things. We get it together. We get it together. Dan kita tengok macam mana keadaan. Macam ni. Dia akan, the simplicity of the matter. Ada sebuah tulis tentang simplicity. Simplicity. Dia akan mendatangkan bagi kemajuan, bagi kebaikan kepada semuanya itu. InsyaAllah.
Okay, satu lagi soalan di sini. Thank you for your invaluable sharing, Tan Sri. If by FPK, we are supposed to develop insan menyeluruh, create environment for their kesejahteraan diri, have we done it?
Sorry, I can't hear that one. The last one.
Have we done it? Have we done that? Yang dikata tadi, develop insan menyeluruh, create environment for their kesejahteraan diri. Have we done that?
Okay, let me tell you that. You have to go and verify this. Apa ni, I have identified people. Apa ni, I cari orang yang mana yang, apa ni, tak ada kemampuan lagi. Develop him and let him. I'm giving you this. This is your charge. Inilah tanggungjawab awak. Inilah tanggungjawab yang, dari segi Islam tu, dia cakap tanggungjawab ni adalah tanggungjawab yang boleh tanya. You're looking for it, it's there. You can do it. Then you can boleh ajak yang lain-lain lagi. Dan kalau misalnya dalam bilik ini, we all get together and get people so that apa ni, kita pull our ranks together. Pull our ranks together. And tak ada peduli yang tentang people yang pula apa ni, bureaucratic, apa ni, kacau semua. Dan tu apa ni, kita boleh capainya. Let us achieve it without any hindrances daripada mana-mana pihak. InsyaAllah, I feel confident that with the, I think I can feel the sense yang ada hari ini, mahu nak buat, put it together, InsyaAllah, we will get it together. So
I hope the question, the answer is clear to the participants that have asked all the questions, which Brother Radin Vishalashe from UM. Yeah, I think I have more space for one more question if there is any other question. Ada satu lagi ruang untuk satu soalan sebelum kita tamatkan sesi dengan Tan Sri. Ada siapa yang ingin bertanya sebarang soalan secara lisan ataupun bertulis? Okey, ada satu mesej ni. Apakah, assalamualaikum, apakah pandangan panel mengenai pembelajaran di luar bilik darjah yang dilihat kurang signifikan dalam PDPC? Pembelajaran di luar bilik darjah, Tan Sri.
Pembelajaran luar bilik darjah yang dibuat.
Yang jarang dibuat.
Jangan dibuat. Jadi masa saya apa ni pilih sebuah sekolah, kalau suka siapa nak belajar bahasa Inggeris boleh. I pick the worst school dari segi guru, dari segi murid yang orang kata bodoh semua tu. Then dari segi kelengkapan, dari segi semuanya tak ada tu. Teruk betul sekolah ni. I pick this school. Panggil dia, saya tambah guru besar. Guru besar ni dia bukanlah untuk naik pangkat. Dia teruk punya sekolah ni tu. Saya cakap, I want to give you this one. You do it. And then, saya kata, berikan dia orang the most impossible goal yang I stated. Sekolah. Budak yang apa ni, D pun tak merasa. Apa ni, guru pun kadang-kadang tak ada dan sebagainya, kelengkapan tak ada, terbalik. And then I said that I want you to become the number one school in Malaysia. Dia cakap dengan orang sini, dia orang kata, you must be crazy. This kind of school, this kind of students and all that. And then I pergi cakap dengan orang, I said, all right, kita semua itu semua buat kan. Then we did a lot of soul searching semua tu. Cut a long story short, kita buat. So you find a way, find a way. And he has really found a way. Itu yang sebenarnya there, I asked a study to be done. Because sebelum saya tu itu cakap tentang sekolah Ahmad Mahir ini, banyak orang kata, ni kan Sri, dululah. Dia boleh temberang lah. Kita pencin boleh cakap apa-apa pun. So, okay, that's very unkind. So, alright, I'll prove to you. Prove to you that it can be done. I am going to get a study to be done. I, masa dulu, I was at San Labi, up to 250,000. Do this study. The study has already been done. Like, written semua. Siapa nak baca tentang boleh tengok anekdote dan semua tu ada rentetan ya, kejayaan yang boleh kita lakukan itu. You're welcome to call Sain Dabi and ask for that copy of the report. Terima kasih.
Terima kasih Tan Sri. Saya ingat masa kita pun sudah mencukupi ya untuk sesi pertama pembicaraan ini. Jadi saya ingat kalau tidak ada lagi soalan yang pressing, kita ingin mengucapkan bagi pihak kuliah pendidikan, khususnya Center for Teaching Thinking kuliah pendidikan, mengucapkan berbanyak-banyak berjutaan terima kasih kepada Tan Sri Wan Zahid Muhammad Nurdin, kerana dalam kesibukan beliau, beliau masih sanggup, from the first day saya tanya dia, dia sudah sanggup untuk berserta dengan kita untuk membicarakan topik ini. Jadi kerana kesanggupan dan kesudian beliau itu yang amat bermakna pada saya dan juga teman-teman di kuliah dan juga para hadirin, kami mengucapkan jazakallah khairan kasiran. Moga usaha Tan Sri akan terus menghasilkan buah yang kekal, dan pesanan Tan Sri walaupun tak panjang satu saja yang saya ingat semua orang telah mendengarnya, especially to teachers and to educational officers and lecturers, okay, you must believe in what you believe and continue, do the fighting, okay. The most important thing is ada orang yang stand, especially the superior, stand behind the inferior, okay, the subordinate, to support them. Because nowadays teachers sekarang ni guru-guru kurang yang berani kerana mereka selalu kata takut kepada pihak atasan. Jadi bukan itu caranya. Jadi kalau pengalaman saya di negara Jepun sekalipun, saya ingat ketika mereka memperkenalkan ICT, guru-guru yang bertukuh lumus secara bekerjasama menyiapkan pasangan memasang wayar dan semua sekit tu untuk ICT umur sekolah mereka. Jadi guru ni peranannya sangat signifikan. Ya? Jadi saya harap kita mengambil tiba daripada pesanan Tan Sri. Jadi insyaAllah Tan Sri, terima kasih banyak-banyak. InsyaAllah kita bertemu lagi. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Terima kasih atas kesempatan ini.
Alhamdulillah. Okey, insyaAllah. Sekarang sampai kita kepada penceramah atau pembicara yang kedua, iaitu satu tokoh yang juga tidak asing lagi dalam arena pendidikan, khususnya pendidikan tinggi, iaitu Profesor Emeritus Tan Sri Dr. Zul Abdul Razak, Zulkifli Abdul Razak, yang merupakan Rektor ke-6 UIA dan juga mantan President International Association of Universities, UNESCO Paris. Yeah. Beliau memperoleh Profesor Kehormat daripada Universiti Nottingham dan juga Profesor Emeritus daripada USM. Pernah memimpin USM selaku TNC selama 11 tahun ya, dan kemudian menjadi Rektor USIM sebelum selepas mengurusi lembaga pengarah USIM. Beliau ada terima Medal Gilbert pertama dari Asia dan yang ketujuh dalam dunia daripada Universitas 21, iaitu Universiti Penyelidikan 16 Buah Negara, dan penerima anugerah sumbangan kepada masyarakat Asia HRD 2017. Penulis buku, beliau menulis buku Nurturing a Balanced Person, The Leadership Challenge. Dan kemudian kami bersama menyunting buku pentafsiran baru Falsafah Pendidikan Kebangsaan yang telah dinyatakan oleh Profesor Ainul tadi, yang menerima anugerah buku negara dan juga anugerah buku MAPIM KPT. Dan satu lagi perkara yang ingin saya jelaskan di sini, Tan Sri ini banyak berkarya dan karya dia merupakan penulis tetap dalam akhbar dulu The Sun, akhbar The New Straits Time. Jadi kita banyak boleh membaca fikiran-fikiran beliau dalam akhbar harian, insyaAllah. Jadi insyaAllah Tan Sri Zul akan berbicara tentang pentafsiran baru FPK ini, melihat pada cabaran PAK 21 dan juga sekarang. Kita silakan Tan Sri.
Terima kasih Prof. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi taala wabarakatuh. Terlebih dahulu saya mengucapkan terima kasih dan syukur, dan bertambah syukurnya kerana saya dah lama tak jumpa Tan Sri Wan Zahid. agak rindu rasanya. Alhamdulillah, we see you well Tan Sri, and I am very inspired by what you say. Many of the things that you say relates and resonates with me very well. I am quite different from Tan Sri Wan Zahid. Let me just make that distinction. We are not in the same league. He's a better person than I am. In education, he's a trained educationist. I am not. Yeah. Saya ni learning this on the job. The experience that he has got, I do not have. But there may be some resemblance that I will tell you later, in the sense that I am as much as he is, mungkin also thick-headed and thick-skin. Eh? In that, I find a lot of comfort dengan Tan Sri Wan Zahid. I'm very fortunate to be in many of his committees. I don't know it's whether by designs or by apa ni, by chance, but we share a lot of synergy in terms of thinking. And indeed, I learned a lot from Tan Sri Wan Zahid, who is actually my mentor in many ways. Yeah. So given that caveat, I let me just tell you, I stumbled upon FPK. I didn't know FPK exist. I stumbled upon FPK when I was made, much to my reluctance, the Vice Chancellor of USM in the year 2000. Yeah, and year 2000, I was given this job. Then I was very happy as a director of the National Poison Center, which is basically my vocation as a pharmacist. And I thought this is a place where I can help people to save lives. And at that time, if you remember, there was a lot of cyanide poisoning, lead poisoning, and the world, in Malaysian world, and that part of respect is not well informed tentang all these chemicals that is around us, and we seem to be very oblivious about it. So when we were given the task to set up this poison center, it's something that I cherish, because we can work directly with the people involved. Yeah, that we got many experience on that. But nevertheless, when I was catapulted into the vice chancellor, so the world is changing. The world of poison centers and the world of education is two different worlds that I will not be able to reconcile. And I was looking for what is the thing that makes in university works, education work. And alhamdulillah, somehow or other, I stumbled upon falsafah pendidikan kebangsaan. Yeah. And as I read that and I see this name, Tan Sri Wan Zahid, there's another name that was there is Ibrahim Bajunid. Yeah. These are the two names that I later on track down to find out who is this person. And alhamdulillah, I met them in person. I'm able to interact with them, and I learn a little bit more about falsafah pendidikan kebangsaan. And of course, Dato' Ibrahim Bajunid as well. I wish him well in this particular respect. And these are the people who actually educate me in the long run. Now, to be a vice chancellor of a science university is a major undertaking. Science University masa tu universiti yang kedua yang berpaksikan kepada sains. We just went through May 13th, yeah? And the university was established during that particular period, and all this I think needs to be reconciled. As a pharmacist, I do not have those tools actually. Yeah? A pharmacist, the work is very easy. We make medicine and we sell medicine, and we are good medicine seller. Right? That is probably the only traits I got. I can sell medicine to you. If you can buy my medicine, I will be okay. So FPK is my new medicine. I'm going to sell it to my university and say, look, this is something that we need to work on. The university has been running on its own, but where are we heading? The big picture, what is the big picture? And this is where falsafah pendidikan kebangsaan becomes an important tools to me to go into education, maybe a license, so to speak. And alhamdulillah, pada tu Tan Sri Wan Zahir was the chairman of ACAP. I managed to edge myself into the committee, and then we learn a little bit more, and then we introduce this to ACAP at the same time. So this falsafah pendidikan kebangsaan mencorakkan hidup saya sebagai seorang pendidik, membagi saya satu purpose, a new sense of purpose, rather than just selling medicine per se. And I didn't go into pharmacy for the very reason. Yeah, dalam pharmacy, and you see how diverse it is from falsafah pendidikan kebangsaan. Kesudahannya sebagai pharmacy, when I need to practice my pharmacy, the rule of thumb is very simple. If there are two medicine is of the same quality, katalah two medicine of the same quality, which one do I want to sell? I will sell the one that has got the greatest margin. Yeah, so Panadol is 3 cents to make, and I have to sell it at 20 cents because it's Panadol. If I sell it as paracetamol, I can only sell it by 50 cents, 15 cents, or 10 cents, then the margin is not good. So I keep on pushing the most expensive drug, although they work on the same thing. And I told myself, I'm not going to earn my living by cheating the people who are already in misery. Orang datang, kita dah sakit, ya. Kita jual ubat yang mahal pula. Macam mana agaknya saya membuat rezeki saya di sana. So I decided not to practice pharmacy. And what else I can do, then I go back to education. Right? But just to find that education is just, it's just the same, maybe not too bad, but dia punya sama juga. You go back to the cerita of Swami tadi, it's all about economics at the end of the day. Yeah, it's all about economics at the end of the day. And this is where I think the falsafah become a savior to me. And I say, what else can we do with this? And reading the falsafah, which I think all of you know, tells me there is a lot more values in the falsafah pendidikan kebangsaan that we have not mined, we have not used, we have not even articulated. And therefore, soal-soal insan seimbang yang ditanya tadi itu, soal-soal the environment, soal-soal yang Tan Sri Wan Zahid kata itu, tidak dapat kita cernakan. That's one part. The second part I want to mention, just also to give you a kind of a relationship with what Tan Sri Wan Zahid said. When I was a student in USM, yeah, we were probably, as a pharmacy student, I'm probably the second batch. We came in 1971. And the year is very significant because that year there was no ACTA, there was no AUKU. So we were a student as a student should be. We've got a student union, the way our students want to behave. And what are the characteristics of the students then? Exactly like what Wan Zahid described. Yeah? What Tan Sri described, we are the most difficult person to deal with in the sense that we ask all sorts of questions. And about USM, when I was a vice chancellor, USM is known as University Suka Melawan, USM. Because we will ask everything that we need to ask before we even move. If you say jump, we will say why we need to jump, not like how high, sir. And now the vice chancellor says jump, you say yes, how high? Yeah? For us, jump, why jump? So these, I think, the traits that has been given to us. As a student at that particular time, we are very critical over what we want to do, whether it meets the target that we are looking for. As a student at that particular time, of course, I didn't know what falsafah pendidikan kebangsaan is all about. It's all about freedom of thinking. We want to think the way we want to think. Yeah, at that particular time, 1971, although I'm a pharmacist, but I learned a little about economics. Masa tu Sam Darby is a different animal altogether, Tan Sri. It is 100% owned by Mat Saleh. You know, Harrison, Crossfield, Guthrie, all these names are the names that we memorize. How many acres of land they've got, what sort of economic outputs they have, how many people are working for them, and so on and so forth. So that we still ask the government that question, why is Harrison Crossfield still here? We are supposed to be independent. Why is Guthrie still taking a vast lot of lands? Yeah, why is Sam Darby is still there? I mean, the old Sam Darby, not the Sam Darby yang Tan Sri kata. So kita punya analysis of the situation is very, very different. We know what the country is all about. We know what we want in trying to quote-unquote liberalize or memerdekakan, to how to fill in merdeka. So that's the kind of thinking we've got as a student, not to pass, not just to pass exams. After all, during our time, exam is at the end of the year. Yeah, at the end of the year, we will study. For the first 8 months, we don't study. We do all sorts of things. We all learn about many, many things. And somebody asked, what happened to bilik darjah? I don't have a bilik darjah. As a student, then my bilik darjah is the world around me. Yeah, we work with CAP. That is another story. The USM in Penang, I think it's a mistake to have USM in Penang because there's a seeds of activism. We have CAP, we have Sahabat Alam, you know, we learn with the people, they tell us what the classroom do not tell us. When I talk about pharmacy, they tell me how corrupt is the pharmaceutical industry in the world. I read those books. My lecturer tells me it's the clinical pharmacy, the pharmacy industry is the best that you need to work for it because they give you a lot of money. But the people outside tell me how corrupt it is. And I learned this now when I look at the vaccines. I'm not very happy about the vaccines because the corruption is there. It's very blatant in front of you. But we are forced to do it, yeah, for one reason or another. But these are the critical thinking that we have then that the student now do not have. The student now are more interested in going out to buy and shopping and then come back, you know. They don't care whether other pandemic, other type of pandemic, that this one is not relevant to them. There are 20 of them waiting for me just now. Lucky I say, either webinar, you come and see me tomorrow, you know. I want to tell you the shape of the students then tells you what sort of education that we are going to have. So I don't have a classroom. My classroom is the world outside. I don't have a specific teachers. My teachers are some of the activists, as Emidres is one. I owe a lot to him. I went to do an assignment to interview him on certain things. It ended up that he interviewed me. You know, because these are the things that you see you should know in your classroom. And I bring this classroom and I ask my lecturers the kind of question that SMEDs ask, and they have no answers because they also are trained the way we are trained in a very stereotype way. So apa yang Tan Sri Wan Zahid kata tu, I really endorsed it. There must be freedom of thinking. There must be flexibility in thinking. And then there was no AUKU. As I said, we don't even report to the Timbalan Naib Chancellor. We do the things of on our own. We decide what to do, you know, whether the project is good ataupun tidak. We go to the community and sort issue of the community and try to solve them the little way you can. So, benda-benda macam ini saya rasakan adalah yang kesudahnya berkaitan dengan falsafah pendidikan kebangsaan. I went back to falsafah pendidikan kebangsaan. I didn't know I'm going to be a vice chancellor then. If I knew, I would have done better. But when I go to falsafah, I say, hey, this is what was missing in the students now, given the beautiful falsafah, thanks to Tan Sri Wan Zahid and the many things that was there that is now, you know, not being implemented for some reason or other. We will go into the reason later on. So I will just stop there. And I just want to relate another point. So 1974 becomes a turning point for me. It was the Baling issue. The Baling issue, I think you know, the rubber price was down students, people are not having enough food. It's almost like the COVID. It was the COVID then. Now, if you look at Baling, it was the COVID then. Tak cukup makan, hari hujan, harga getah turun, Harrison and Crossfield is still there, Guthrie is still there, making tens of money, but people are not getting what they're supposed to get. Now, I want to tell you this because last week I met with Tun Musa Hitam. Tun Musa Hitam somehow or other wanted me to join WIEF as a board member. I'm quite happy to do that. But we also relate to the story. Masa tu, Tan Sri Musa Hitam was the Minister of Primary Industry. He was sent by Arwah Tun Razak to solve the problem of Baling. It was the 4th of December, I still remember, 1974. All of us were already there in Baling, 5,000 students from all over the country. Of course, USM is one of those, you know. And I was there as well, and Tun Musa Hitam, then it was just Datuk Musa Hitam, is supposed to come and pacify the person, yeah. he came late. I told him hari itu, I said, Tun, why do you come late during that? We were waiting for you, you know. Dia kata, Zul, to tell you the truth, kata dia, my plane, Cessna, the twin engine, when I was flying from Kuala Lumpur to Penang, I nampak engine-nya bocor. We have to turn back and change the plane, and that's why I was late, kata. Oh, we didn't know, but it gives him a hard time because he comes late. Rakyat dah tunggu, menteri masih tak datang. So he was booed and so on and so forth. Now I know it wasn't his fault anyway. So we had a debate. Honestly, I think he was on the stage. We were on the ground. We had a debate. We asked him, what is this all about as far as Baling is concerned and so on and so forth, you know? And after that, this is a story that I want to tell you. After that, bila Tun Musa finished with Baling, he stopped in USM. And we have another session with the student. As a minister of primary industry, dengan student, we have a very civilized discussion of what is the issue at hand. You know, so there is this communication between student dengan menteri in a very academic, intellectual platform that we begin to understand what is the issue, and he begin to understand where are we coming from. And I think that does not exist now. You know, kita when we look at minister, we almost, you know, drop our pens sometimes because we don't know what to do with them. But we don't have that intellectual level of discussion. And I think this again, where the falsafah pendidikan kebangsaan becomes a very good platform to open up discussion within whoever wanted to talk about education on a very intellectual level. So I will just stop there. That gives you a kind of a background where I'm coming from, and also to make the difference between what Tan Sri Wan Zahid is in the falsafah, and what I'm more of a user rather than a person who reorientates and make this happen. But certainly understanding the falsafah now is something that I think is no option. If you want to go into education, you must understand this falsafah. Otherwise, you have no business to be in this place, because you will just screw it up and make it worse, because the intent of the falsafah has not been met in any what you call discernible way, and the way I see it. So I stop there, Prof, and if there's any question, you can shoot.
Okay, Alhamdulillah. I thought Tan Sri will speak a little bit more longer because we still have time. But anyway, he wants to stop here. Do you want another round or? I mean, for today, this is it, Tan Sri, yeah?
I could, but why don't we, if there's any question, I will clarify those questions first, then I can.
Oh, okay. Okay, then.
Another round, yeah.
Okay. Okay, then. Jadi kita buka floor ini kepada pertanyaan. Kalau siapa yang dah tercabar dengan Tan Sri, banyak yang beliau riwayatkan tentang latar belakang beliau, bagaimana beliau bertemu dan berkecimpung dengan FPK kita ini. Dan saya ingat semua pengalaman tu sangat menarik, ya. Jadi kalau ada siapa yang nak bertanya soalan ataupun Izzuddin ada collect any question dalam chat, kena chat, saya check, ya. Okay, ada lah ni Tan Sri. Okay, let me see. Okay, there's one here pasal inspirasi. Dia kata terinspirasi dengan cerita Tan Sri Zul. Ia tak mungkin berlaku sekarang. Ahli politik sibuk nak kumpul duit dan jaga status, dan student disibukkan dengan tugasan. Jadi ini satu komen saja mungkin ni. They inspired. Yeah. Unless Tan Sri nak komen. Another one, ni question lagi panjang sikit daripada seorang guru. Terima kasih Tan Sri Zul. Ya, aktivisme di Penang mengajar saya banyak tentang dunia sebenar yang memaknai pendidikan. FPK menjadi sesuatu yang asing apabila ia kelihatan tidak dapat diukur secara empirikal dalam dunia pendidikan pasca milenial yang memerlukan semua hasil pendidikan diukur dan dibentang. Secara empirikal, semua hasil pendidikan diukur dan dibentangkan dengan nombor dan ranking. Bagaimana cikgu-cikgu boleh memahami kepentingan keseimbangan insan ini dan memperjuangkannya, kerana realiti sebenar tidak begitu. Are you thinking among teachers, freedom of expression, freedom of speech never has never existed in Malaysia education pada pandangan beliau lah.
Yeah.
Semacam
Tasri. Okay, let me deal with the second question first, because this way I see the difference. Yeah? When I joined the academic world, I joined the academic world for a simple reason that in academia we set our own goals and limit our own targets. Malahnya bila saya menjadi pensyarah muda di USM, saya tidak ada KPI. Nobody tells me to publish, nobody tells me to do what. I just want to do what I want to do. You know, so I make my own agenda, and one of the agenda that I have pada ketika itu adalah untuk menolong orang-orang kampung, untuk menolong budak-budak Melayu khususnya di Pulau Pinang. Kita tahu mereka lemah daripada matematik, bahasa Inggeris, science dan sebagainya. Setiap-tiap minggu, without fail, we will organize a tuition class in the kampung to make sure that what they learn this week is understood for next week. Every week without fail, you know, and there's no KPI for this. Nobody even asked. It wasn't even reported in our CV, because we think it is part of our duty to educate people, you know, and therefore you cannot blame anybody if you are not doing what you're supposed to do. Now, if I ask my lecturer to do it, then they will say, ini bukan KPI saya, Tan Sri. So go to hell with KPI. And this is exactly what we want to do in IUM. Kita mengiktiraf KPI itu, lepas itu kita merungut. Siapa suruh kita iktiraf? So for me, there's no KPI in that sense. We decide, IUM, apa KPI, apa benda kita nak buat. And this is where we are now at this stage, trying to decide where the university wants to go and how do you want to actually be recognized. Bila kita cakap tentang community engagement misalnya, apa yang kita nak buat? Macam mana kita nak recognize this? And macam betul Tan Sri Wan Zahid kata, think for it and then work for it. Tapi kalau kita masih menunggu kementerian-kementerian kata apa, kementerian nanti marah pula. Kementerian is kementerian, universiti is universiti. Kementerian cannot think the way the university thinks. Orangnya orang birokrasi. Dianya hidupnya dengan KPI. Tapi kalau kita sujud dengan KPI dia, habislah kita. Yeah. So, isunya adalah isu kita. Kita tidak boleh salahkan orang lain. Kita yang patut berfikir, especially kuliah education, you are all educationists, you know what to measure, how to measure, assessment is a big thing for you. Yeah. But if at the end of the day, you can always think about KPI, then who else to be blamed? We blame ourselves. Yeah. So that is what, when I came down to the university as a lecturer, there's no KPI. I work on my own. I look at the books or buku bahasa Malaysia kurang. Saya terjemah buku bahasa Malaysia. Yeah, I think I finish about 8 terjemahan dalam buku bahasa Malaysia tentang benda-benda yang tidak ada. Right? Research. Okay, apa research? Saya tengok I was interested tentang traditional medicine. Kerana lagi sekali ini bahan-bahan tempatan tidak ada umat bahasa. Saya buat research on traditional medicine. I do it because of the sense of purpose of bringing what is needed relevant to the community, not because of KPI. And certainly, alhamdulillah, kalau we do traditional medicine, it is unique. It get published. You know, it get published. So we need to think independently as an academic. And I think this is the biggest thing that we are facing at the moment in time. If you surrender and say academics has nothing to do with this and you just want to wait for what falls from the sky, then I think you are in the wrong business. I think you should go to the pharmacy business and they will tell you exactly what to do, what to sell, what to do, what to say. You know, you should not be here. Here is people thinking independently in a positive way, not thinking independently in a negative way. Right? And I don't want it to be forced onto me because I am quote unquote an intellectual. And I want to exercise my intellectual rights. So that's the second question. And the first question is apa tadi, Rosnani?
First question tadi.
Pasal kumpul duit ni. Memang tak salah lah kumpul duit. I think kalau saya tak kumpul duit pun tak betul juga lah. Tapi saya kumpul duit.
Dia.
Ahli politik sibuk nak kumpul duit. Ya, betul. Bukan ahli politik, orang akademik pun kumpul duit juga. Sekarang kadang orang akademik ni dia banyak lagi duit daripada orang politik. Orang politik dia kumpul duit, dia belanjakan untuk rakyat. Orang akademik ni kumpul duit, dia buat apa?
Ya, dia inspirasi tadi. Dia kata, apa ni? Ahli politik sibuk nak kumpul duit dan jaga status quo, dan student disibukkan dengan tugasan.
I think basically bagi I back to the same issue lah.
Tak mungkin berlaku dah sekarang. Cerita Tan Sri itu.
Mungkin berlaku kalau kita ada kebebasan berfikir. Hmm. I mean nobody can stop you from thinking. If you think people can stop you from thinking, then I think you, I don't know, unless you don't think lah kot. Yeah. If you really want to think, nobody can stop you from thinking. I think this is the difference between people who fight for freedom, for the freedom fighters, people like Nelson Mandela, 27 tahun dalam penjara, keluar jadi presiden. Kalau dia tak berfikir, dia tidak akan boleh keluar jadi presiden. Ya, yeah? Tapi tengok, dia jadi presiden untuk satu penggal saja. Dia tak gila pangkat. Ya, yeah? He could have been a president for life. But Nelson Mandela chose only to be a one-term president. Donald Trump, sebodoh-bodoh ni nak jadi dua term. Nelson Mandela one term and that's it. Because he's a thinking person. So don't tell me that you people can stop you from thinking. Unless you are not a thinker. Yeah? But as an academician, you have to be thinking. Whether you think right or wrong is a different story, but we must be thinking, and I think nobody can stop you from that. Nobody can imprison your mind. When they keep you in prison, when we student demo dulu, banyak juga yang masuk penjara. Yeah? Tapi dalam penjara inilah budak-budak yang masuk dalam penjara ni, bila dia graduate, dia dapat first class honours, second class honours. Kenapa? Dalam penjara tu tak ada kerja lain, dan baca buku je. Maybe that's the other benefit of it. Yeah. So I do not surrender by saying that because there's so many rules and therefore we stop thinking and we are not be able to pursue this. I think that is not what the falsafah pendidikan kebangsaan tells us. And this is where the word kesejahteraan diri becomes important. That we develop our inner strength. And the inner strength is what kesejahteraan diri is all about. We are trying to reconceptualize this. Yeah, from the Islamic point of view, from the Malay point of view, from different cultural point of view, but it becomes a positive force for us to be a good academician, a good teacher, and a good learner at the same time. I think that is where I think the falsafah pendidikan bagi saya gives me a source of strength and motivation to move forward.
Okay, Tan Sri, ada satu soal lagi ni.
Yes.
Bagi merealisasikan FPK, bagaimana membina dan membentuk akal dan budi anak-anak masa kini yang lebih banyak belajar, kut-kut belajar di media sosial daripada para pendidik mereka di dalam kelas?
Okay. My makalah dalam utusan, I just make an advertisement. Hari
Selasa.
Selasa, hari Khamis besok. It's about angkara media sosial dengan remaja. There is enough evidence now under the COVID menunjukkan the remaja will face a lot of mental health because of social media. And this is another thing. Bila kita baca tentang teknologi, kita semua bercakap tentang teknologi seolah-olah ianya sebagai satu penyelesaian tentang apa sahaja masalah, termasuklah social media dan sebagainya. Yeah, kita tidak ada langsung dalam ungkapan. I think Prof. Rosnani, if I'm not mistaken, there is a chapter in our book tentang falsafah pendidikan kebangsaan dengan teknologi yang ditulis oleh Azideh. So maknanya again kita boleh gunakan falsafah pendidikan kebangsaan menilai. Sebab itu kita panggil tafsiran baru. Yeah, bagaimana kita melihat falsafah dalam konteks teknologi yang ada? Kalau kita menggunakan falsafah itu menilai benda-benda yang kita dapat, mungkin kita dapat menyelamatkan bukan saja pendidikan tetapi anak-anak kita sendiri, bahawa benda-benda ini bukan untuk pendidikan. Social media is not for education. Social media now is about membawang. Yeah? It's about bitching, it's about, you know, all the negative thing that you want to say. I can talk about Rosnani without telling who said it. I can criticize her till cow come home, but she doesn't know who criticizes her. And that's the freedom I've got. And that's a fake freedom. The freedom in academia, if I want to criticize her, I will tell you, Zulkifli Razak criticize you so that you can respond to me. And that's where knowledge develops. But here, no, I tell you, here you are the lousiest buggers and I just forgot about it. And she did not know who to respond to. It is not a medium for educating people. It's a medium for bitching, it's a medium for getting likes, for heaven's sake, you know, whatever it is, first, you know. You show part of your arms, you get 300 likes, and you show another part of your arms, 5,000 likes. Later on, you open your baju, you get 10,000 likes. What? You know, and this is how we train our children. And this is how we tell them, oh, the social media is what. You should stop telling them what you should tell them what is social media is all about. Facebook was boycotted, if you remember, by thousands of companies when they promoted hate. There was a stop hate campaign on Facebook, and they boycotted it. Now, that is on companies level. Why can't we tell our students to boycott social media if they are not telling the truth as far as education is concerned? And this is where we go back to the falsafah. Falsafah mengatakan apa? Mesti kita mempunyai pelajar-pelajar yang seimbang. Yeah? Pendidikannya dari segi inteleknya, rohaninya, jasmaninya. I think you know this better, the Jerry thing. And if they got this Jerry thing, then they will not misuse social media. But they don't have this. And therefore, the social media become a whim and fancies for them to say whatever they want. Sometimes they're frustrated, macam di UIA juga, they're frustrated with something else. And suddenly, they criticize the Tugu. I don't know where the Tugu comes from. Yeah. So they begin to, you know, find areas that they can release their attention. And social media is a perfect way to do this. And this is the issue that I think we need. So kita as an academician, what do we do? Have anyone spoken to the school children and say, social media ini dia gunanya, ini dia yang kita tak boleh guna. Macam mengguna bahan merokok lah. Yeah? What is a negative impact? Do they tell you what is the negative impact? We didn't. Malah kadang-kadang kita melayan dia pula dengan social media. So the responsibility, brothers and sisters, actually is us. If we don't do our duty as an academician or as an educationist, then I think we just have to be blamed. And plus, if we don't even know the falsafah pendidikan kebangsaan, we have no framework to work on this. So dalam pembicaraan hari ini, kita mengharapkan we will write a few more chapters. That was my suggestion. Yeah, the second edition, inshallah. By the end of this year, I'm hoping that we can write a few more chapters on COVID-19, how do falsafah pendidikan kebangsaan settle the question of COVID-19. What is COVID-19? COVID-19 is about humanity. COVID-19 is about working together. COVID-19 is about shared values. COVID-19 is about going back to the society and help them. And that's everything that falsafah pendidikan speaks about. So we hope to write one chapter on COVID. If anyone wants to do this, you are more welcome. We want to write one chapter on AI, artificial intelligence. Everybody says artificial intelligence, AI, is a solution for this. But the debate in the international world now, who writes the AI? Basically, it's a male, white male writers. Yeah? And they are no different from what we are having today. Kalau the Western white male writers are the one who write AI, then we use the AI as though it is something neutral, then we become quote-unquote colonized again in a very subtle way. It's the same white person that colonized us with a gun some years ago. Now they're coming up with something else. Yeah, but we didn't know this. Now, where is then the Asian, the upper AI writers? Where are the Muslim writers? What is Islamization in AI? Now, these are issues that we need to think about before we get, you know, dumb into another lizard hole. So this session yang Prof. Rosnani buat ni, I think, has a lot of is a many prong sort of thing. So what are the new chapters that we need to add? I've already written, I think, there are four or five new chapters that we want to add. Inshallah, we'll come up with a the second edition for Falsafah Pendidikan Kebangsaan by the end of the year. Yeah. So any more questions?
I think there are a few. Maybe I can read them and then you will pick up which one you think has not been answered. Okay.
Yeah.
The first one is Salam Prof Zul. Do you think it's time to revisit FPK based on current needs of society, family, and self, and also digital citizens and many other transformation in the world of education? Education 4.0 challenges many aspects in FPK. I think Education 4.0 or IR 4.0 or AI. What is your take for the future of Malaysia education system? Okay, that is one. I guess because we have been talking about critical thinking, being intellectual and so on, she's asking based on current needs of society, family and self, and digital citizen. And then there's another one. Apakah persiapan yang perlu para guru atau akademisyen lakukan menghadapi senario baru pendidikan global dalam membina generasi baru negara yang dapat memenuhi matlamat FPK? Ini persiapan guru dan akademisyen. Okay. Let me read some more. Soalan daripada Krishna Veni. Ketidakmatangan guru dan kedua penekan yang keterlaluan pada pencapaian dalam periksaan adalah punca FPK tak dapat direalisasikan. Mohon pendapat. Is that the reason? Iaitu ketidakmatangan guru dan penekanan yang terlalu berat pada peperiksaan. Kemudian ini satu lagi ni. Zainurin ni. What is the best way to sell pardon this word ideas in FPK to one very young student to two non-Malaysian students? Okay. So you can respond to any one of them.
Okay, and there's a lot that, but the common denominator bagi saya is basically COVID-19 tells us that FPK is relevant.
Okay.
Yeah? I think Allah Subhanahu wa Taala has made in such a way that FPK is very relevant to COVID-19. I basically will underline three or four things. Yeah? FPK talks about balance. COVID is about imbalance. The imbalance between society, the imbalance between upper nature, that man is pushed into a frontier that they now coexist with animal, they can jump species and so on and so forth. That is already one area that we need to be careful about. Kalau kita ajar pelajar-pelajar kita tentang keseimbangan, bukan kajik keseimbangan diri kita mengajar tentang keseimbangan melalui alam sekitar dan sebagainya, there's already one idea that will save us from the next pandemic, you know, that you are not going to sacrifice the environment just because you want to create macam orang tadi tu just to mengumpul duit saja. Yeah, so that is one. So in other words, dalam konteks kita di UIM, kita bercakap tentang balik soal khalifah ni lah. How do we protect the earth and how do you protect the survival of human being at the same time in a balanced way? That is already one part of the FPK yang saya rasakan penting. Yeah, the second part of the FPK yang saya rasakan penting when we talk about the word kesejahteraan diri. You need to start with the internal sort of spirituality. I think we are very strong in spirituality. Yeah. And spirituality means what's the values? What are the values? The values is about sympathizing with people is one value. Yeah. Dalam keadaan sekarang ini, how do you sympathize with people who do not have food? How do you sympathize with people who do not have shelter? How do you sympathize with other people that do not have what we have? And that is a long distant thing. So I can sympathize with people in Yemen, in the Rohingyas in Myanmar. I can sympathize with them. That is if I cannot do anything. Then the second level, you talk about empathy. Empathy, maknanya, you need to be there. So when you talk about poverty, we don't study poverty in the aircon room in the library and say, oh, this is what poverty is all about. You go to where poverty is. And this is where the question out of the classroom tadi. You learn from them what poverty is all about. You experienced it. Yeah. And we are going into this Ramadan thing. This is another lesson that how do people actually suffers from poverty? And then it becomes a real thing for you. So when you give money to people because they are poor, you know the reason why you give them money, not just to show off. Yeah, and not just to make yourself feel good. You really understand what this is all about and how do you actually contribute to this in a small way. And more than that, if you can do it, some people will do it. Yeah? And last but not least is values of compassion. We talk about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala being compassionate. If Allah can be compassionate, why can't we? And what is compassionate? Compassionate means rahmatan lil alamin. There's no barriers to this. So we are not only talking about the Muslim, you're talking about the non-Muslim. We're not talking about only human being, you're talking about the animals. Alhamdulillah, today we are working on the policy of human of animal care in IUM. When you see a cat running around in the campus, what do you do? Itu tengah makan ni, cat di bawah berkeliling ni. Nampak tak reti dia? Yeah? What do you do? How do you save this cat? Yeah? And these are the issues that I think we need to go into. And this is all about kesejahteraan diri. It is Islamic, it is concept. Katanya Melayu, but it is not non-Islamic in that sense. It's human in this context. And these are the things that the falsafah pendidikan. Why kesejahteraan diri ini important? Because falsafah mengatakan orang yang sejahtera dirinya akan boleh menyumbang kepada keluarga, masyarakat dan negara. In other words, if you experience happiness, if you experience peace, then you can dispense peace. If I have not experienced peace, how do I dispense peace? Yeah? If I have not experienced sejahtera, how can I make other people sejahtera? Saya dari rektor nak membuat masyarakat UIM sejahtera, tapi saya ni bengis. Yeah? How saya mesti, bila jumpa Rosani ni kena marah aja. Hal-hal kena marah aja. Because I do not understand what sejahtera is all about. And I cannot convey sejahtera to other people. And this part of the problem in campus, part of the problem in organization. Because we do not educate ourselves. The leadership characters now is basically, the moment you become the leader, you change everybody else but yourself. Yeah? And I want to share one story with you. And this story, I think, will probably stick in our mind for a long time. Yeah, it's a story about a guru and the pupils. Yeah, the punya lesson to the pupil is very easy. They kata, I'll give you everybody one banana each, right? But all you have to do is, can you eat this banana where nobody notices you? Of course, it's a simple exercise. So everybody go to the toilet, eat banana, somebody ate, go in the jungle, you know, they hide themselves. Except for one person. The next day, orang semua dah makan banana, they bring the peel and tell the guru, I've done it, simple exercise. I can have two more bananas and I can finish this. Yeah. But except for this guy, he's still holding the bananas and everybody laugh at him. You can't even solve this simple solution. Yeah. And the guru asks him, why are you not eating your bananas? They kata, sir, I cannot eat the banana without me watching myself eating the bananas. You know, the lesson is that we never watch ourselves. We always watch other people do things. What we do, we never watch. If you start watching what you do, then you find you have other things that you need to correct yourself. And that's a lesson that we need to learn from falsafah pendidikan kebangsaan. We start from inside out rather than outside in. All these KPIs outside in, not inside out. So these are things that I think basically when you start to deal with it in the most intellectual way, then you find there are many things of the falsafah that we can learn. And the moment we practice this, I hope IUM will practice it, then everybody will come to IUM and say, hey, how come you're different? How can you survive without KPI? And then we can start telling them. And then we can tell, then the medicine seller will come in. And this is how we sell it. Yeah? Tapi kalau kita pun di sini cannot do it, you know, I don't want to go into bigger issues of this. Tomorrow we'll talk about it. Then we say, you are ini cakap je. Yeah? Tapi nothing happens to them. They are just like us. Sometimes they are worse. I think this is the reason. I think this is the force for me to demonstrate that what we say and what we do is what we actually is the same. We are not saying one thing and doing differently. And I think that is the spirit of the falsafah at the end of the day. I want to end you up with a story, with another thing.
Oops, what happened? Tak dengar. unmute Tan Sri.
Oh, I on unmute.
Okay.
Okay. We have been involved in UNESCO punya workshop since last September in what we call the Futures of Education. I think you can see that, yeah? Futures of Education, and this is a synthesis report that we were, there are 25 people from different countries, and Alhamdulillah, IIM is one of those. Now, dalam report ini, this is the draft report. I just want to share with you. I'm very excited. If you look at the table of content, mungkin it's not clear, but I just want to show the evidence of it. Kalau ada, I think you look at number two. With soul and solidarity, 2.1 is education with a soul.
Okay.
That is our contribution based on the falsafah pendidikan kebangsaan. So in other words, if you really work on it, we are able to tell this even to UNESCO. Now UNESCO have taken it and say the falsafah pendidikan kebangsaan of Malaysia is important as we move forward to the future. That's why saya tanya Wan Zahid tadi, what is his prognosis on the falsafah pendidikan kebangsaan. Given the COVID environment, the falsafah pendidikan kebangsaan become very, very, very relevant. But we need to make an issue of it. You need to make examples of it. You need to tell them that this is how it is working. You know, and I think that is our business now. I'm really glad that Rosnani has started this. And I hope we can move along this line. We don't have to talk about the happening in the past. I think that's gone. But how do you now frame the falsafah pendidikan kebangsaan moving into the future and become part and parcel of this UNESCO report? UNESCO report will be launched in October this year when they have a world conference on higher education, and I hope the falsafah pendidikan kebangsaan will come as one of the examples of how education in the future can be done. So I have a lot of hope, and I want to remind co-ed, my first visit in UIA, August 2nd, 2018, was to the kuliah. We had a meeting, and that time, I think you were probably surprised that we planned for that seminar, which happened in November, and the book came out, and Alhamdulillah, the book now, I think, is doing well. So let's look into the future and see, macam Wan Zahid kata, let's look at the future. Buat apa yang kita boleh buat lah. Jangan murmur apa yang kita tak boleh buat. I think there's many things that we can do. Buat apa yang kita boleh buat. Let us be the place where we can recollect balik the soul. He talked about the school of lost souls. How do you bring back the soul into education? How do you give it back to the people who needs it? The people who doesn't need it, that's fine. But there are a lot of people who needs it post-pandemic, inshallah. Yeah. So I'm sorry if I take too much time, but I am very excited over this. And I would like to thank Tan Sri Wan Zahid. He is very much a person who also instigated sometime. He pushes me to say something or to work on something, and I'm really indebted to it. And certainly, the co-ed and the IUM, I think you have given me a lot of support for this, and I hope we can go on working. And certainly other audience, other listeners who are interested in FPK, please come and contribute at the same time. Yeah?
Okay,
I'll stop there, Ruthani.
Thank you very much, Tan Sri. You end just at a good time. I think based on the speeches made by two of our honourable speakers, we have learned, kita telah belajar banyak, telah dapat banyak iktibar ya, tentang insan itu sendiri daripada Tan Sri Wan Zahid, tentang sebelum kita nak melakukan falsafah tu, pembinaan insan itu sendiri, ia jadi insan yang kukuh, yang berani, yang bijak ya. Seperti falsafah Yunani dan juga kata Al-Ghazali lah, yang bijak, yang berani, ya, yang temperance, sabar dan sebagainya, ada empat ciri. Kemudian kita sudah lihat bagaimana gigihnya Tan Sri Profesor Emeritus Zul, ya, telah dalam caranya sendiri berusaha untuk merealisasikan falsafah pendidikan kebahasaan tersebut dalam setiap aspek kehidupannya, ya. Walaupun beliau bukan dalam bidang pendidikan seperti ramai dari kita ni, guru, ya, guru berlatar belakangkan pengurusan pendidikan, ya. Tapi tak ramai yang dapat menghayati seperti mana Tan Sri Zul, walaupun bukan dalam bidang pendidikan khususnya, tetapi seorang pendidik di universiti, tapi telah mengubah penilaiannya untuk menegaskan kepentingan FPK ini dan sangat penting sekarang sehingga mendapat sambutan dalam UNESCO dan beberapa universiti antarabangsa, ya, dengan usaha-usaha beliau. Jadi insyaAllah this is not the last from Prof. Zul. Sebab beliau punya banyak idea. Jadi insyaAllah kita akan kongsikan idea-idea tersebut kerana idea itu boleh mencerahkan kita. Kita perlukan orang yang mencerahkan diri kita dan kita mungkin perlu orang yang boleh membuat kita berani menjadi lebih kritikal dalam pemikiran kita. Jadi kita perlukan orang yang bidang falsafah juga insyaAllah pada akan datang. Ya. Walaupun ada satu persoalan tadi Tan Sri dikatakan kenapa kita perlukan seorang pemikir kritikal tapi kita tidak mengadakan khusus, kita hentikan khusus falsafah di UIA. Tapi tak apa, now no time to respond, okay? Mungkin next time, ya. Jadi saya kira alhamdulillah satu hari yang sangat banyak manfaat yang boleh kita perolehi dan Krishna kata apa, dia orang kata dia akan support, insyaAllah kita akan buat kayak ni. Kalau tidak sebulan sekali, kalau tidak dua minggu sekali, sebulan sekali insyaAllah, ya. Kerana Ramadan pun sudah hampir, kan, ya. Jadi bagi pihak penganjur iaitu Kuliah Medication, UIA dan Center for Teaching Thinking, saya mengucapkan terima kasih kepada kedua panel yang sudi hadir pada hari ini, meluangkan masa mereka kerana mereka adalah orang yang sangat sibuk, ya. Dan juga kepada para hadirin yang sangat meluangkan masa kerana para hadirin juga sibuk, ya. Nasib baiklah, alhamdulillah hari ini cuti sekolah, kan. Saya harap ramai guru sempat bersama kita di dalam dua saluran yang lain, ya, insyaAllah. Dan kita terus berdoa supaya mereka ni sihat dan terus berbakti dan kita juga sihat untuk terus berjuang. Jadi sekian saja. Waqulu qawli hadza, astaghfirullahalakum. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Terima kasih kerana semua soalan dan penyertaan. Okay, assalamualaikum.